Hi, I'm John Williams from WGN Radio, which stands for the world's greatest newspaper, and that's the Chicago Tribune. Today is Wednesday, June 24th, and Chicago Tribune columnists Eric Zorn and Mary Schmich join us to talk about a few things in the news. Eric and Mary, how are you?
We're okay. We missed
Welcome
you all
back
last
from your
week.
Cruise.
Yeah, how about that? I was in Alaska.
Now, were you with listeners? Is that what
with listeners who were nice people? We had a really nice time. And Alaska, I will say this, never having been there before, I'm glad we've got one. That place is so unlike.
You cruised up the fjords, past the glaciers.
Illinois.
Yeah,
it's just, it's nice. It's like another planet compared to the cornfields and soybean fields of Illinois. Glad we got the soybeans. Glad we got the mountains.
Do you entertain on the, do you like the magic show?
Anytime I'm with people, Eric, it's entertaining. You know that, but I don't do magic shows. I don't juggle. We have a cocktail party. We go to dinner and we go on some amazing excursions. So let's go back to Chicago for a second. Anthony Abadi, the about-to-be former Chicago police officer, was convicted of battery for beating a bartender in Chicago a couple of years ago. And the reason it's spectacular news today is because the judge said he should not go to jail for that amazing 30-second video that's been seen worldwide. What do you make of that sentence?
Well, I think if you look at the, I mean, the judge said basically, as a judge, he is required to look at a bunch of factors. And you look at all these factors and
no
this
priors.
Is the kind of case, yeah, with no priors. There was not a lot of physical damage done to the bartender whom he beat up. I guess the decision is that in most cases like this, and other things that I've read support this, in most cases, probation is the sentence,
right.
that you get probation for this. The thing that's outrageous about it from my point of view is, first of all, this what he said on the stand, his contention that he was acting out of self-defense, that he was in fear of his life at one point.
Of a woman who was about half his size.
Right. Literally, 125 and 250.
Listeners, maybe you'll post this as a podcast, the interview that you did this morning with the body's attorney, trying to contend that, well, she kind of started it because she pushed him down when mm-hmm. he was trying to walk behind the bar for the second time.
Which right? wasn't seen in the video that we've all seen.
Well, you do see her pushing him away, and he does seem to slip. But I think those two factors. But the other thing that really bothered me about this was when the judge said, well, the fact that this was a really public event, that it was shown internationally on video, makes no difference to me. And I think that the nature of this crime, the reason that it is so important, was that he was a police officer.
Well, he is a police officer, and that has at least two major effects here. One, when she says that she is now scared of the police, even though she's, you know, careful to say, I know I probably shouldn't be scared of the police, I am scared of the police, even if there wasn't huge physical damage to her, there is big psychological damage that goes beyond, I think, just the psychological damage of having been beat up, you know, a woman being beat up by a guy, but being beat up by a police officer. And that fear, I think, legitimately extends now for her out into the world of the people who are supposed to protect her.
Right.
There's also the issue of the fact that I do think that police officers should be held to a higher standard.
Even off-duty police officers, in
their public lives. You know, maybe not in the privacy of their homes, but in public, off-duty police officers should be held to a higher standard.
I agree with that, and I think Mary makes an interesting point about the fact that the judge talked about the harm done because he didn't break her nose or didn't break her arm.
He said just a few bumps and bruises.
Yeah, but the idea that you could that you would actually have that it would only be physical injuries that we consider, something like that.
One last point, though, about the Abadi case, and that is, to me, that they didn't really take into account the psychological damage. The judge made it sound like, well, if physically you're okay, then we don't have to worry about anything else. And the lady said that it's ruinous to her marriage. She vomits when she gets upset. She really has a lot of psychological trauma.
Do you think it's too much to compare it to rape in that way? I mean, rape doesn't do physical damage to somebody, right? The crime of rape is all about.
I think it's very close to rape. I mean, there is a difference, but a large man inflicting violence on a woman, there is a special kind of violence that goes along.
And I think the judge missed that. I think the judge missed that.
Second story. Let's talk about in Iran. Neda, is it how you pronounce her name?
Neda,
the 16-year-old girl who was shot by what looks like a sharpshooter at a protest after the election. She bleeds out, and you see her die on another widely circulated YouTube video. And that has really become sort of an iconic moment of Iran and the election. What do you guys make of that whole story?
Well, first of all, the video is horrifying. It's similar in some ways to the beheading videos that you see.
You don't see her get shot, but you see it seconds afterwards.
Oh, but you see the effects.
Yeah.
And when she bleeds out, it's worse than what you see in TV. You know, on TV, you see somebody, you know, go oof, and they fall down, and then maybe there's a little pool of blood behind them. This is really awful. And it, you know, of course, obviously, it's one person, and you can't, you know, make too much of one person dying, no matter, you know, what the circumstances are. But a person like that becomes a symbol for a movement.
Well, and so, I think it's interesting how movements need symbols. And symbols are most effective if they're young, if they are attractive. I mean, she is a very provocative, evocative symbol of this.
And it is interesting.
This is a youth movement. It's not just that young people are coming out into the streets to protest. But I do think that we are seeing a new moment in Iran, and that it's being propelled by young people with a certain kind of energy. I mean, it's almost, you know, the equivalent of the Obama young people.
But you know what I have to say about, you asked what I think about this story. I don't really understand what, aside from frustration with this election, what is behind this movement philosophically. These aren't like pro-Western people demonstrating. I mean, I don't believe that this was like
a
contest between, you know, big bad Ahmadinejad and then you know the Howard Dean of
this
Iran.
Is not a counter-revolution. They weren't out there to protest, let's get rid of the government. They do, though, want more transparency in government. They want more rights. They want human things that a lot of people around the world do. But are they saying topple the government? No, that's not what this was.
And it's not. I don't think it's a plea for a Western style.
No, not at all.
Or in any way an anti-Islamist thing. And so there's still a lot of hatred for America intertwined in all this.
Yeah,
too.
But I do think that there are ideas about democracy that have filtered through into this younger generation in Iran, and you know that they have become aware that they are living in a really repressive society, and there's just some resentment about that's bubbling up.
Right. Don't you think it's an interesting democratic thing happening too? Big bad government can suppress people or own the media, but if I've got Twitter.
But you know what? I heard an interesting guy from Harvard the other day talking about how we have really overplayed the Twitter aspect of this.
Really?
I think he said there were something like 1,000 people in all of Iran who were actually on Twitter. 1,000. It's not that many people. That people were communicating with each other by much more traditional ways, telephone and all of that.
Blogging is big in Iran.
But what was happening was that the people who are on Twitter were tweeting to people outside Iran who were then retweeting those tweets.
So we knew more about it maybe than some of the
about it, but yeah. It's not like there really is a huge amount of information coming out of Iran on Twitter.
But it's giving a sense of momentum it gave a sense of momentum to the movement. And I mean, being retweeted means that your audience multiplies in ways that it
if out of well, even
but,
if but, out of
but,
Iran,
but outside of Iran.
Not
so it's not feeding the what's going on in Iran nearly as much as it's feeding us outside.
Still, the
of
way
it.
That we handle tweeting, the business of operating with Twitter in America is that it's silly. Celebrity tweets are the new fun thing to make fun of, and I haven't heard anybody have a serious discussion about Twitter except that isn't it frivolous? And all of a sudden, it felt powerful. Just like that.
Well, and it was powerful in India during whatever the hostage taking was in.
But the point is, don't you wonder if maybe the social media suddenly have found that they do have a little gravity, that they can be game changers. It's not just a way to find out. I mean, Twitter has been nothing but a celebration of the inane, right? And Facebook is really social. But
Except
all of a sudden, it felt to me like it was important.
No, I agree. I think that there I've never thought that Twitter's just inane, and I think that there is
well,
some
you
legitimate.
Tweet, yeah.
No, but I think there's some legitimate ways of communication now. And now the ways that I've been using it, you know, basically.
Yeah, and I wasn't knocking you, Eric, but
no,
you got to do it in 140 characters or less.
No,
you can't
exactly,
have complicated thoughts.
But I think there is a way. I think there is a way that this does that. It subverts attempts to stop people from communicating with each other because they were knocking out cell phone things.
Right,
they were trying to knock out the internet.
I don't think Twitter is going to change very much in this country because we don't have the need for it to change. You know, we're not living in a repressive society. We're not living with the kind of urgency that the people in Iran are living with. We're going to continue to tweet about stupid stuff.
Not to get too heavy, but there are ways in which Twitter and social media spreads information and spreads stories, you know, true and false.
Yeah.
But the idea that, you know, that big media can keep a story story hidden or not linked to it and keep people from reading it is really going away.
Because, I agree.
Because what Twitter does is it disintermediates big media sometimes. I've got a story and I can get it to 1,000 people.
Great
and
word, then, disintermediate.
Right. But then those 1,000 people spread it to their people so that I can write something. If I write something really vital on a blog that nobody reads.
I'm waiting for that.
It can be.
It's going to happen. Let him finish the thought, will
you? It's going to happen.
Okay.
So it can spread. I mean, I think that's an important aspect, not necessarily in this story.
Two other tributes to communication, then we'll wrap this one up. Ed McMahon has passed away, and somebody said something about him that reminded me of what somebody else said about John Calloway, the legendary Chicago broadcaster, and that is they were both originals. You know, they were really... I don't know how else to describe it, except they were what they were. And Ed McMahon, by the way, was cheesy. He was a pitch man. He was a sidekick. John Calloway was not. But they both really were the very best embodiment of that.
They were originals, but in a way they were both also everymen.
Yes, exactly.
Everyman.
Without pretense. I mean, even Ed McMahon, he wasn't slick. He was, you know, the pitch man. And John Calloway was not a pretty boy on TV, and he didn't seem to care either. He had something he wanted to say. He wanted to talk to you, and that's all that mattered to him.
Yeah, I hate to put those two in the same sentence.
Right.
I mean,
I don't mind it.
Because, I thought John Calloway was brilliant. And he was a great interviewer. He was an amazing person to run into. I mean, I'm not someone who's like friends with him. I was friendly with him, but you know, he wasn't a personal friend. But I would love running into him and love talking to him and love watching him because he was so openly curious, so good with the questions, so good with the answers. I was on a panel with him a month or two ago about the future of media.
Yeah.
And he was just, you know, he spoke in parables almost, in little crisp sound bites. He was an amazing guy.
Yeah, I think we had on our site that his death was the end of an era, which made me think, I feel like we keep coming to these ends of an era. Studs Terkel was the end of an era. He is the end of an era, but of a slightly different era.
One last thing I want to say, speaking of you'd like, Mary, for all of us to sort of polish this off with something fun to do, no C or B. Okay, here's my latest book, Horse Soldiers. Have you seen it in bookstores?
No.
It's one of the better-selling nonfiction books right now, current events. It's about the war in Afghanistan. Doesn't sound like fun. It's not a fun book, but it is so well written by a guy named Kevin Stanton, Horse Soldiers. I couldn't put it down during my cruise. I would recommend it.
I'll put a link to that on my little red blog.
Yeah.
I want to recommend the. It's called Double X. It's a website from Slate, and it's written by and edited by women. And it's. I know it's not supposed to be for me, but it's brilliant. It's a wonderful
voyeur
blog.
You're not supposed to go there.
It has a great blog and really smart writers writing about politics and culture. So Double X. I'll put a link to that too.
Mary.
The new modern wing at the Art Institute. Walked down there at lunch the other day. It was just fantastic. It is just light. Airy. You see these paintings that you've seen as postcards for your whole life, and all of a sudden they're there, and the paint has texture, and the colors are vibrant.
The guard says, don't touch the texture.
I know, you really do want to reach out and touch it, but it's just a fantastic public space with this great bridge that leads from Millennium Park over to it. Just walk in the bridge, even if you didn't want to pay for admission. They do have some free admission now, I think Thursday and Friday evenings.
Sounds right.
Maybe more. So, go.
The Tribune's Mary Schmich and Eric Zorn. I'm John Williams from WGN Radio, and we'll talk to you again next week.